Boom. So listen, this is a special, very special conversation that has been happening here. And what I do want to say is, I want to say that if you are a young person who is inspiring to get into this game, this music game, yeah, you 100% have to stick right here and listen to this conversation. I'm going to tell you why in a piece. The one thing I will say to you is, I'm about to have a conversation with two people that I respect to the highest degree. These are the man that could ring me and say, yo, Chucks, can you meet me at, yeah, what time? They could ring me and say, Chucks, you know what? I got this thing, yeah? If you could turn up at, yeah, what time? Where? Yeah? It's literally like that, yeah? My guy Ricky Blue,
respect, brother.
Glenn Akins.
I'm gassed.
Yeah?
I'm gassed.
Listen, that man could ring me and say, Chucks, I've got this thing, where? Huh? What time? How you both doing, my guys?
Respect.
Yeah, all good, yeah. All good. I swear all the last good. Time I asked you, you said, well, I'm in Paris or something like that, you know?
Yeah, do you know what the worst thing I was going to say? Like, the intention's definitely there, but Chuck's diary these days? Yeah, what time, boy?
you see what I'm saying?
Nah, do you know
but
what,
next man? Week we can make it work.
Yeah,
he will make it happen to your credit. You
bro,
will make it happen.
The game is about finding your feet, and once you find your feet, running. Do you understand what I'm saying? But going at a nice, steady pace where you can. And so, yeah, I have to give thanks. Things are all right. You know what I mean? Things are good with you, yeah?
Yeah, man.
Yeah?
Can't complain. We're here.
We're still here.
It's, oh, Mugs. Yeah. We're going to talk about that. Do you know what I want to do, yeah? For anyone who doesn't know, because there will be a lot of people who still don't know who you are, yeah? And the significance that you have, as far as I'm concerned, to our culture. Individually, just briefly, I just want you to just talk just a little bit about your early beginnings. I want to start with you, Ricky. Like,
okay,
just talk to me a little bit about how you started in this thing.
I started off as a budding rapper, very,
right,
very early. Very, very, maybe not.
Wow.
I just started telling people that recently.
Is it? Yeah?
I just started admitting because old videos started surfacing.
Yeah.
I was like, oh yeah, that did happen once upon a time.
Yeah.
But basically, most people know me from Channel U because I used to manage Channel U. Mm-hmm. But that wasn't the beginning of my journey. I came across Channel U while I was on the road selling my own music.
Mm-hmm.
And a guy that I met and I was selling a CD to was just starting a TV channel and they were looking for content. And of course, I was around that same generation of people like Estelle, Rodney P, Black Twang. I went on tour with Black Twang back in those days. And so I knew a lot of artists who were in a similar position to us where getting on MTV Base was a myth.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you had the 30 grand video and you had the strong American accent, it wasn't really for you. And you had to be signed as well.
Yeah.
So when they told me they were starting this channel and looking for content, I just went around to all the people I knew on the circuit who had the same issues I had and just collected all of that content and bring it to them. And they were like, all right, could you do this for us full time? And I was like, all right, sweet.
Mm.
And it kind of started from there. And my first intention was that, all right, I'm going to put my group on TV all the time was my thinking. And I got there and realized that no one's going to respect that. So I kind of fell back from being part of the group and more managed the group.
Mm.
But that was that journey from, you know, starting out from just doing our own thing at our little independent record label called Road Records.
Yeah.
That was our little thing, selling our CDs on the street. Had been on like 279, Westwood, Big Ted and Shorty Blitz doing the old freestyles and all of that, like from early. So kind of been around from a very early stage in the game. And then the Channel U era was when I really started to understand and learn about the music business.
Right.
Obviously Channel U exploded alongside the grime scene. So you're pretty much talking about, you know, Dizzy Rascal's Boy in the Corner and everything around that, Lethal B's Pow, Kano, P's and Q's, and just the real setting of what grime became.
Yeah.
It kind of happened in that same generation of Channel U.
Mm.
So, you know, in that early days, you had like, if I remember rightly, One Extra had just started and was, people didn't really care, not in a rude way, people didn't really care about One Extra. They were more bothered about having their video on Channel U than
definitely.
They was about having their song on One Extra.
Yeah.
And I say that just to say that our partner at the time, they became like our almost like partners almost because they're playing the music and we're showing the video, if you'd like. And so culturally, there was a lot of exchange there. So, you know, my journey at Channel U and the channel's explosion and me managing the channel meant that I met a world of people. Two particular people that I met, Tim Blacksmith and Danny D, taught me about publishing. I had no idea what publishing was. And I would have thought that I was in the business, right? Mm-hmm. I knew what a manager was. I knew what a record label was. I'm talking about publishing. I'm like, mate, what are you on about? Mm. And they invited me to a showcase. I think it was the Brand New Heavies or something like that. And they were doing a showcase for radio. And there was all the mainstream radio there. And I went there and no one cared. No one knew or cared who Channel U was or who I was. Mm-hmm. And it was the first time that had happened to me. And I was like, okay, where's the ground? Like, do you get what I'm saying? Like, where am I?
Yeah.
And that was my first introduction into what was, if you'd like, mainstream culture or radio, yeah. if you'd like. Yeah. And come out of the land of commercial, which we was far from in our bubble of Channel U and underground music.
Yeah.
And so that really opened up my eyes and I took a lot of lead from them. Almost from that point, it was like, you know what? These guys are teaching me something that I don't know. Let me listen. Mm. And as I say, they told me about publishers. I was like, look, you ever find something, let us know. I had no idea that Wiley, Da Vinci, that these guys were songwriters. Mm-hmm. I never saw, like, I thought, you know, a guy busking at the train station, white guy with a guitar and long hair, there's a songwriter. Mm. Do you know what I mean? So that's the tape I was sending to the guys. Mm. And I was ignoring all of this Tinchy Strike, all of this stuff that was happening here, and that I knew these people, I just didn't recognize that they were songwriters. Mm. So I ignored all of that and was sending them nonsense. And my moment of clarity actually came through when I did a talk at a youth center, which I've always done from time to time. I did a talk at a youth center in Holly Street. Me being from Channel U was like there to try and inject a bit of hope that, you know, you can try and do something in music and be that, play that role if you'd like. And the music teacher was the same age as the kids that I was talking to. The music teacher was Labyrinth.
Okay.
And he had like Let the Sun Shine and other tunes then. He had no idea that he was an artist and he wanted to play me his music. So I was like, cool, he played me his music. And I was like, rah.
Talented
this
brother.
Is good.
Yeah.
So I sent that to Tim and Danny and they came back to me quickly like, yep, this is great. You know, how let's meet him, blah, 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 blah. And long story short, Labyrinth became my first signing
right.
To publishing. And then it gave me my barometer for what was good.
Yes.
And I discovered Naughty Boy on MySpace not long after that. I've managed him since. We're in like our 11th year of working together.
Sick.
That would be like my second touch point of working with Glyn, because I met Glyn when I was at Channel U. He had just signed Roll Deep.
Yeah.
And they were putting out that project. Mm-hmm. And so we had met then, but then we re-met again around Naughty Boy because I had just started managing him and he just signed a single from him.
Okay.
And then Naughty Boy introduced us to Emily Sandé. We signed Emily Sandé. He signed her for records. Naughty introduced me to Sam Smith. We signed Sam Smith's publishing. And in a very short period of time, all of these guys just exploded. Within 2 years, you had Labyrinth producing and performing on Tiny Tempest Pass Out and what was probably the most important album of that era.
Massive.
for our culture.
Massive,
right?
Massive.
You had Emily Sandé went on and sold 5 million albums, mm-hmm. right? Sam Smith then turned up and did 10 million albums. So you're going from the UMA Awards to the Mobos to the Brits, to the Ivan Novellos, and then to the Grammys like a very short period of time, right. It was just a real whirlwind of a journey, and to put it into its context as well, like, again, Tiny was a massive deal as in the beginning of that cusp, right? So you had Pass Out, Frisky, all the rest of it, but then you had Written in the Stars, and we managed Eric Turner, who features on it, and Issue, who produced it. So we was tied into so much of what was going on. And then Glyn, I know obviously he'll tell you his story, but there were so much different things that he was doing artist-wise. A lot of my producers were working across those projects, like Emily, Professor Green, and others. There were just so many cross points that, we just built a really good relationship working through the good, the bad, and the ugly of everything that comes with the different stuff that we was doing, but always been able to move the thing forward, regardless of whether it was a positive or negative scenario. Yeah. We worked through it and found our way, if you'd like. And that kind of really built a bond, if you'd like.
I can see, like, now, even as you explain that, kind of how you two sort of connected together to even, you know, do the label thing, which we're going to get into in a moment. But I do want to go to you as well, Glyn, because I know you're rich in this thing as well. Like, being around for a minute, signed some of our absolute legends and stuff like that. But you go.
Well, while I was at university, I fancy myself as a DJ and a promoter. I used to put on parties, which meant I just was hanging out in record shops all the time. And through hanging out in record shops, I met this girl who worked at a PR company, right? And she was like, why don't you come and do work experience? And I was like, at the time I was working in Boots, like, well, you know, while studying, and I was coming to the end of uni with no idea of what I wanted to do. So I was like, yeah, fine, I'll come and do 2 weeks work experience. So I did 2 weeks work experience in this PR firm called Media Village. And they were like they did like PR press and promotions. And they just, with Sony, funnily enough, they just started to introduce the street team concept into the UK. And so after 2 weeks, the chap that runs it, Shabs, he offered me a job to run the street team. And that's how I started. Mm. And so like a street team was like, you know, you're just putting up posters around lampposts and then, you know, handing out flyers outside clubs and CDs and whatnot. And I went to doing like club and radio promotions, right? And then I was there for like a year or 2 years, and then Media Village turned into Relentless Records. That's when it started, and that is when, and then I was sort of promoted to like to A&R, and I guess it was because all through the time I was there, I would always walk in with records and like, have you heard this record? This record's massive. They're like, well, what do you mean it's massive? How's it gonna get on the radio? And at the time, I had no idea what they were talking about. All I knew, this record's massive. Sounds like a hit record to me. And, you know, and there were like two records in particular I picked out. It was like Chocolate Boy, Sweet Like Chocolate. Right? When I remember hearing that in a club, I'm like, this record is enormous, right?
Yeah.
And it was that, and that went to number one or whatever. And then, What was the song? It was one Carnival. I think it was like Who Let the Dogs Out or something like okay. that. So I'm like, yeah, this song's massive. People are like arguing with me. I'm like, no, it's massive. Top ten records. So they're like, okay, so you think you can hear hit records? Go on then.
Yeah.
Go on then.
Yeah. You tried to.
Yeah. Go on then. So then I must have been. The transition between Media Village and Relentless Records, there were still like projects we're doing PR for. And we were doing a campaign for Activision, who made this Wu-Tang Clan game. It was like Street Fighter, one of those kind of beat 'em up games. And I organized this like national competition, and I went on tour with, hired Tim Westwood, and we went on tour. Like in every city that we went to around the country, there was one record that just kept playing, and people were going mad. And it was the Artful Dodgers and Craig David's Rewind. And at the time, UK Garage, I wasn't really that into it. I was like hip-hop and R&B and dancehall. But in those days, like when you had the clubs, like the big room was House and Garage, and then the little room was R&B and hip-hop. Mm. And I never went into the big room. Because I was like, boof. I'm like, nah, mate, I'm not even. Sorry. But when it went round, like this record, like all of this record just kept playing. So I remember like I'm phoning them up at the office. I'm like, this record, I've heard it everywhere. Everyone's going mad. It's mad. So then we like track them down. All those, and that was the first record that I ever signed, was that Rewind record.
Crazy,
massive hit record. And that was Relentless's first release. That was the first release of the label.
Right? Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh,
that's how it started.
Okay.
And then after that, and then they were like, okay, so you've heard it once. Let's see if you can do it again.
Yeah.
And then went on some crazy run of then Pied Piper and the Masters of Ceremonies. Do You Really Like It?
Yeah.
So that was number one record, right?
Yeah.
And then I met the So Solid crew.
Mad.
He's like, my brother was telling me about them because he used to listen to their pirate station. And they had this one record called Dilemma. It was just like a long bass line and whatnot. And
like, you know, I always say that, honestly, this is my hot take, yeah? Dilemma is like one of the first grime rhythms.
But funnily enough, when I heard the record, I'm like, I don't know what you want me to do with this. Like, they'd be like, oh, it's just massive. I'm like, I hear you, but like, there's no singing on it. I literally was that. And then I heard Oh No. And I'm like, yo, that's the tune. And I remember went to Battersea, the Chopper Pub in Battersea, sat and met Mega. That's the first time I met him, actually. And he explained to me the whole vision that he had. for the crew and what they were doing and what they had already set up themselves in terms of they had a radio station, they had an artist booking agency, and it was some real entrepreneurial shit. Which I didn't particularly recognize as entrepreneurial stuff at the time. I'm like, this is just, you know, this is just fantastic, is all I thought. But when that record came out, at that time it was CD singles, and on CDs you could, you know, you have the main version and remixes. And ultimately, the rules are the entire length of music on a CD single has to be 20 minutes. Any longer than that, then it qualifies as a budget album.
Mm-hmm.
And we put one too many remixes on the CD, and it say instead of going into the single chart, it went to the budget albums chart.
Oh, mad!
And it was like, at first of all, it looked like some sort of it was like, okay, this is a horrific mistake.
Yeah.
But for some reason, like in the press, they thought the press took on this story like, okay, these guys are anti-establishment, and this is them putting their fingers up to the system, and it just snowballed into these guys are just rebels. This is the new punk rock or whatever, and they ended up on Top of the Pops with that song, right? And then after that, talking to them, it was like, okay, what do you want to do next? Because we had another single, something like two or three singles or whatever. And they were like, we just want to put everyone on one record. And it was like, I think there were like 10 MCs or something at the time. There was 30 people in the crew, but like 10 MCs. And they were like, yeah, as long as you could do it in 3.5 minutes, it's fine. Like, thinking that they would be like, oh, perhaps we can't do that. So they just went away and divided 3.5 minutes by 10. 21 seconds.
Yeah, 21 seconds.
Seconds. Yeah, and that's how that record, that's how that record came about.
Yeah.
And then... And then Mega explained, this is the vision they wanted for the video and blah and stuff. And I was like, well, I've never seen anything like that before. If you can bring that to life,
yeah,
that would be amazing. We found some directors to do it. And then I remember I was going to a lunch meeting, and my boss called me back to the office. He's like, you got to come back now. I'm like, oh, okay. I came back and he said, watch this. And they saw the first edit of the video. My mouth was open.
Crazy.
I was like, oh my God, I've never seen anything like this. People can go mad.
Right?
Mm. And we decided to premiere the video in a cinema in Leicester Square. And I remember the cinema was ram.
Yeah.
There was queues outside and everything. And everybody went berserk when they saw that video. And of course that was a number one record. And then them performing at the Mobos, flying to the stage on zip wires and then they ended
that's
up
monumental yeah. moments. Yeah. I urge anyone who hasn't seen these things, yeah,
mm-hmm.
go and Google them. They're documented.
Yeah. I mean, believe you me, watching it now was like, it was one of those things that I didn't really quite understand what was going on at the time.
Yeah.
At the time, but looking back, I'm like, that was literally a watershed moment.
Yeah, no doubt.
Do you know what I mean? Because no one had ever seen anything like that. You only get stuff like that from American artists.
Yeah.
From like big American hip hop artists. So for that to come, and I think that probably was the thing that started. The journey towards grime and everything and everything that's come after, you know, in terms of there was a British sound that was our own, and we were only competing with ourselves.
Yeah, no doubt.
Do you know what I mean?
No doubt. And so obviously, naturally for you now, because
mm-hmm.
this is important, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
One of the reasons why, like, even that journey in particular is important, because there's an opportunity that is going to come up in this conversation that I think you should hear about. Do you know what I mean? And the process in you just talking about something that you did with a record and was a part of or whatever is relevant to
what we'll
eventually get to. But then obviously your A&R sort of career
it went bizarre.
Some of the acts you signed
after that. So then it was Lethal Be Funny. Ricky mentioned Powell. That was one of the records I signed, and I remember that was another one. The record just caused absolute pandemonium.
Didn't it get banned?
It got banned from certain clubs because people just
listen.
Couldn't be
I remember it playing it one time, Area Nightclub, Watford.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the promoter came straight away and said, "Nah."
We're not having that.
They tried to ban it from the channel at that point as well. I remember getting complaints to Ofcom and everything about the record.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, there's that, and then, you know, sign Roll Deep, like Ricky said, sign Roll Deep. The first time, so Roll Deep, with their project, The Avenue, which we did. And then remember that had a hit record, Shake a Leg, it was called. And then that kind of led me up to the time of Naughty Boy and then Emily Sandé. And funnily enough, and within all of that, it was Roll Deep again.
Yeah.
Signed them again with a couple of singles they had. Good Times and Green Light.
Both number one records.
So it's like, so all of the, so I guess my, the journey, like my, I guess my, sort of my come up in it was always centered around just hit records, like loads. And like, you know, I was fortunate enough or lucky enough to be able to sign a load of records, like, in that period, it was something like 8 number one records or something.
Crazy,
boy. Yeah, but it's like number one singles and stuff. And then it was like, but then the challenge was, is like, okay, you can hear hit songs, but can you find a hit act?
Right.
Do you know what I mean? And then that's what then brought me to Naughty Boy, because he had this song with Wiley called Never Be a Woman, and there was this girl singing the hook. And we're like, who's the girl? And that was Emily Sandé. Met her and. And funny enough, he's like, Naughty Boy was her biggest champion at the time. 100%. He was the first to recognize it, and he absolutely believed in this girl, right? And it was like, you've just got, and he's just like, you've got to hear the songs. And he played me this song called Daddy. I'm like, I had never heard nothing like this before. And then he played a song called Clown. And like, these were like the demos. Ooh. And I'm like, I have, in my working career in A&R, like we all heard great artists and great vocalists, but in my working career, it's like coming across an artist that I'd never heard anything like it. And I'm like, I've never heard nobody that can sing like this. And then discovered that she wrote the songs herself. And the lyrics were like, crazy. My mind was blown. And I was like, there was some industry hype around her, but not loads. And, you know, I guess an artist like her, we hadn't necessarily seen an artist like her succeed in a while. So I guess there was some sort of skepticism of whether you could have a black female artist. Mm-hmm. Would it work in Britain at the time? But I'm like, well, anyone who can sing like this and also write songs like this, surely they've got a chance.
Yeah.
they've got a shot on there. And the thing is, I remember seeing her perform, and the thing that struck me that was special about her is that technically she's a brilliant singer, right? She's technically a brilliant singer, a brilliant vocalist. But there's loads of technically brilliant vocalists.
Yeah.
Her magic was she. I saw her reduce somebody to tears with the way she sang, and only the greatest singers can do that.
Trust me.
Yeah. Do you see what I mean?
Trust me.
Like that is, and I say that is magic.
Because I remember point, just to quickly interject, where she had so many like great songs that she had written, a lot of them with Shah, and everyone was coming round to try and wanting these songs for their own artists.
Yeah. Mm.
Because as Glenn said, they weren't looking at her as the artist. Mm. It was like, you know, let's give the song to Cheryl Cole and let's give the song to, because they look like the archetype pop star.
Right. Mm.
So if you give them that song, they'll fly. And
was it Leona Lewis?
Yeah. I remember the point when it was almost like, no more. You like give away no more. Mm. Do you know what I mean? Like focus on your own thing and whatnot. And,
so I remember I think even Simon Cowell offered like a large amount of money for that song Clown. Mm. And I was like, absolutely. No, I think not, it was like, I couldn't have stopped it. If she decided to give away, I couldn't have actually stopped it. Mm. But I was bold enough to say, absolutely no chance. No, don't you dare. Don't you dare. Yeah. And of course, then she goes on 5 million, like 2012, that was, she dominated that year. You couldn't move for everywhere. And like some enormous performances as well, the Olympic Games, the opening ceremony. And then she ended up being the star of the closing ceremony because that's where that song Read All About It. Yeah. She sang her version of the song.
Of course.
Which prior to that, it was a song by Professor Green.
Who was A&R at the time.
And I remember asking her to sing the hook. Because it was already the hook was already written, mm-hmm. and it was unusual to ask her to sing something she hadn't written. Yeah. So it took a little bit of convincing, and I basically took the risk of saying, I guarantee you this is a number one record, and you can never guarantee anything.
Yeah, you can't
anything like that. But I was so gassed. Yeah, I was like, no, this is a number one record, and then. Luckily for me,
it worked out.
Luckily for me, they performed it on X Factor.
Okay,
and it went straight to number one. It went straight to number one, and then I was like, well, you know, like Jay-Z and Alicia Keys, you should do your own version of the song.
Yeah.
And she's like, and then about 2 months later, after me begging her, she just called me up and sang me that version of the song down the phone. I was like, oh my God.
We're going to make it. It must feel like you hit the belly. You know when you find the artist that you know that is like, could really move.
And that's the thing. It's like, you know, all of the accepted wisdom was that was not supposed to work.
Yeah. Mm.
Right. But when you're standing in the middle of it and you're hearing the music and you're hearing the songs, I'm like, I'm not understanding why this won't work.
Well, yeah.
And then you just develop that tunnel vision to be like to drive it through.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
That era was literally just one hit
after the other.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It was such a golden
across the various different.
And you both worked with Crept and Conan as well, right?
Yes. Then later on signed Crept and Conan. Yeah. The manager.
Yeah, exactly.
He's the manager.
There's a funny story behind because I always give class, like Crept and Conan are like they were the last of that generation and the beginning of what I call this generation.
Right.
Because they came at the end of the Tainese, Professor Green and whatnot, and they shifted it because they bring it to a space where, you know, they were having success but without making what people may deem as pop music, if you see what I mean.
Like, don't waste my time. Charting with mixtapes and that.
Yeah, Don't Waste My Time wasn't trying to be anything other than what it was.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so it represented a real shift culturally. And I think that the likes of, you know, Section Boy, Stormzy, DJ Hussis, etc., all came after that. So they're like, I see them very much as the end of that chapter and the beginning of the chapter we're in now, to be honest with you.
I would agree with how I view
their journey. And importantly for me in my own career is at that time, because of the success that was had with your Naughties, your Emily's and your Sam's and whatever else, there was this thing where we're just doing pop. Like, so some people in the underground scene viewed it as, yeah, them man are over there doing pop. You know, you don't bother with them because they only care if it's a number one record. If it's a number one record, they won't care. Like, people were actually saying that. I remember people telling me that. And I was like, okay, we've got to get back to the roots then. Mm. And so
I remember someone saying that to me. I was like, yeah, but don't you want a number one?
Yeah, exactly. I hear that still.
So yeah, work with them who I knew before, starting to work with them at that point where, you know, where they were starting to, you know, take their thing forward and the work with a major label now and all the rest of it was like a turning point and also a shift culturally into what, as I say, has then come on to be today, to be fair. So an important time and important.
So the label, at what point, yeah, because naturally you two are doing hella business together now. Mm. Yeah, things is, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Connections are being made. There's a working relationship there, yeah? Talk me a little bit through the conversation of, you know what? Why don't we just? Like, I wanna know that.
It's a bit like that.
Yeah, I wanna know. Tell me about that conversation, and then tell me the thought process behind since 1993.
I probably was in my office in the middle of the night, right? Yeah. And I was talking to him, and I was like, most things in my life I've done, I've always done it because I kind of got to this thing in my head where I can probably do that myself, type of thing. And then we've been talking about, we just talk about everything and everything to do with the music business. And I was like, you know what? We could probably do this ourselves, you know? And I think that it just that the opportunity came about because I was at Universal, at Virgin EMIs, I was at Universal. But the chairman of Sony, Jason Eiley, he became the chairman like 6 years ago. And like on three occasions, two or three occasions, he came to say, look, you need to come to Sony. And I was like, yeah, I don't know. And probably in my own head, I just wasn't clear on what I wanted to do next. That's probably why I was like, no, I'm not sure. Do you see what I mean? And but then it became, from our conversations, it just became clear to me that we understand how to do this. We understand how to deal with things when they're good, but also understand to deal with things when it's bad. Right? And I think that's the test of any relationship. Sure. Right?
Everything has been successful, by the way.
It's important to know, though, I've been saying for a while, the game's about runs, man.
Life's about runs, and you
get them, and then sometimes it slows down for a bit. But once you have the belief and you know what it is that you're doing,
but also when you know what you want to do as well, being clear about that is very important, right? And so from the conversations we were having, it's like, actually, we could do this ourselves. I thought to myself, oh, actually, there's an opportunity there at Sony to do this. So why don't we? Then open up the conversation again with the chairman. We all sat down and talked and like, look, this is what we're thinking. This is what we want to do. This is what we're going to do. And he's like, yeah, fine, let's go. And then
we were like, really?
Yeah. But I mean, it's like, you know, because we had an idea and an ambition.
Yeah.
They had a need in terms of just rebuilding the sort of the A&R identity of the company. So it was just perfect timing.
I think things had been shifting as well in terms of, like, you know, not just culturally in the music but also in the business. Things had shifted, like, you've seen, as Glenn said, you've gone from CDs to streaming, and these changes, you've lived through these different changes and been around enough things that have worked well and things that have not worked very well to know that actually we know actually how the system of this works. And coming from our different perspectives, me as a, you know, publisher stroke artist, writer manager to start with, and Glenn from an A&R perspective, and meeting in the middle of those two journeys, because at some point you kind of have to end up doing a bit of all of it, if you see what I mean. Like, as you grow and you evolve, you end up doing a bit of all of it. And I think that, you know, our common strengths made us a really good team, and we knew that because we had been through so much already that we had worked our way through. So we just knew that, and it just kind of made sense as the next stage of our evolution. We had both come from particular schools of being taught this business as well, and we knew that we knew what the similarities and what the differences were about those schools that we came from, if you'd like. And it was almost like a coming of age, almost like, do you know what? It's our time to do our thing now, and what can that look like? And this is what has come out from that.
Having all of that experience makes a lot of the artists that I know where they've come from feel comfortable to have conversations with you, because they know that, all right, cool, like, you know the business, and you almost come from where we come from, and that, do you get what I'm saying? And so, like, that again counts for something too. Do you get what I'm saying?
100%. And I also think that that's part of what this evolution has become, because, you know, record labels stopped being places of if you'd like, talent development, and became more of a place where you acquire it when it's about to happen or when it's happening. And so, you know, there became a lot of managers became like, you had to start developing acts to bring to a label, if you see what I mean. So part of the role started to merge. Not all of it, but part of it started to have merges. And so you're at a point where you're doing more and you're learning more about the business. And I've always credited Glenn with being like, to me, he's always been the best, the number one A&R in our culture, to me. I've always thought that. And I don't just say that because he's my business partner. I've always thought that. Mm-hmm. Like, most of the acts I've ever signed, I signed to him. It wasn't an accident. Mm-hmm. It wasn't because I thought I was doing him a favor. No. Do you see what I mean? Like, you know, and with the history of what he's done from, you know, Rewind upwards, I'm not sure there's anyone as decorated as him within our culture. Mm-hmm. So I knew that there were immense strengths that he had that he could also share with me, and vice versa, because we're coming from two different sides. Mm-hmm. I'm not trying to be what he is, and he's not trying to be what I am. And that's why it works mm-hmm. so well together, if you see what I mean. So imagine, so we've started. He's still contracted at Universal, so he's obviously there doing what he's doing.
Seeing out my contract. Yeah. Seeing out my contract. And at this point, I should say, seeing out my contract, I've got no idea what he's doing.
So like, and I'm like, shit, all right, gotta, you know, get things moving, and get things right, if you'd like. And there's a bunch of exciting new talent coming through, and I happen to have been introduced to Fredo by it was the second time I was actually introduced to him. He's managed by Sincere. I knew Sincere before then, when he first started rapping. His first video I put on Channel U, That's Not Gangster. So I've known him for years, right? So I've known him as someone who I've helped put videos on a channel before, then later managed him as an artist, and then he's gone on to further his career into his clothing business, and then he comes full circle, and he's coming back to now manage artists, and he tells me about this kid, Fredo. Now, a cousin of mine who's from the same estate as him had told me about Fredo at the very beginning after 8100. When I heard the music, I heard 8100 and I heard another five songs, and the other five songs, I was like, he needs a bit more time to develop. It's clearly it's new and it's early for him, but it's good what he's doing. So then Dion has turned up with like, what do you think of this kid? They're like, and I was like, okay, this seems good. Let's link him. And so linked him and Mouth and played through the songs. And I was like, do you know what? This one makes a lot of sense, you know? And felt like it was the right timing of this new energy and this new generation. Because again, I think spotting the trends in terms of the shift of when culture's shifting and moving from one point to another is something that I think we can see, you know? And I could see that was this was next, basically.
That's a cold one as well, but I'm finally gonna lie, because what he went on to go and do, the tours that he ended up, some of the arenas that he ended up doing, the shows that he was putting on, literally showed his development in that, from that particular time all the way up to now. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah, crazy evolvement as well, because you're starting off from scratch in that sense, and just letting him do what he does, if you'd like, and trying to just slowly but surely nudge it further down the line. But it's got to happen in his time. Like, he's got to be ready.
Yeah, definitely.
If you'd like. And, you know, that's had an exciting start with him. And then obviously there was the drill was just starting to emerge, if you'd like. And then we ended up signing Lowski, who obviously was like, at that time it was like him and then Heady One, in terms of at that point coming out through the drill scene. They were like the exciting ones emerging, if you'd like. And again, being this, our thing is that we also always want to be distinctive. And we felt like he was a very distinctive artist in a distinctive lane. And so we invested in Lowski and a couple of others. And then, you know, I think the one who's really done the wonders for us, if you'd like, from a commercial perspective, because we nailed the cultural side with those first two, would have been H.
Massive. I remember someone sent me like his freestyle. For a straight rhyme freestyle. And I was like, okay. Well, I don't know, what do you want me to do with this? It's always the same thing. I'm like, what do you want me to do with this? And it was like, in town, like, no, you've got to meet him. So I was introduced, met him and the manager. But then when we sat down with him, looked him in his eyes, we're like, okay, like, this kid's clearly, there's something about him.
Yeah.
There's something about him. And he can rap his ass off as well. But like, but there's something about him.
He was unapologetically normal.
Yes.
Do you see what I mean? I'm not trying to fit into what they're doing or fit into what you lot are doing. This is what I'm doing. And I'm the guy doing this.
Yeah.
And I'm comfortable with that. Exactly. Yeah. There was something very brave and refreshing in that. Mm. And, you know, and as Glenn said, he could rap his ass off. Mm. Then you've got the thing of, well, he's white. Mm. You know, so if you get that right, you potentially have a wider audience. Mm. Mm. Even the most gangster rapper liked that normalness about H.
Definitely.
Because when they're with their little brother or whoever that one person is, or two people are in their life that they can be really comfortable with, there's an H in them.
Definitely.
If you understand what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? So they like that because it's like you're owning that. You're not trying to be anything else. I can just respect 100%. You for being that.
Mm-hmm. And I remember having a conversation with him actually, and he was talking about, like he was doing some construction job or whatever it was. Mm-hmm. And then, then he just jumped in one of the whips and that. I think someone, but his manager just took him down after he finished work, came to check man and that. And literally, he then decided from then, you know what, I'm really gonna start working properly at this. And
it's not that we knew that's gonna be a hit or that's at that point. It's that it's really exciting and it's a point of difference.
Yeah.
And again, looking at our roster, he almost didn't fit our roster because people had this perception because of the rappers we initially worked with and signed. That we was doing some gangster rap label.
Yeah, that you
do you get what I'm saying?
Some Master P too.
Death Row.
He kind of balanced off that thing and bring a different energy to the brand and what we're doing, you know. Mm-hmm. And of course, he was successful and had some hits too.
Yeah, he had a couple of big hits actually. Yeah, man. Which is always helpful.
Honourable shout out to H. So tell me about this, the opportunity that has kind of come up. Like, what is it? Like, shed me some light. I've got something funny to tell you, actually. Mm. All right, I'll just tell you it now. So, boom. Glenn hits me up and tells me about something that's going on, whatever, yeah? And I thought, when you said it to me, I thought you was sending it to me. So I was thinking, right, like, what? Okay, mad, because obviously I've got a lot of things going on. I've got my career. Like, obviously I've always thought about looking after artists, but I've never thought about, like, you know, being an A&R or whatever. So I've come off the phone and I'm thinking about this every day. Like, could I do it? I don't know if I could, like, I've got things going on, all that, whatever. Chatting to a couple of my brethren, yeah. Then I'm like, you know what? Sure, let me just ring Glenn and just let him know where my head's at. So I'm like, yo, Glenn, you know what it is? I've been thinking about this and that and, like, because obviously... Then Glenn stops me and says, are we talking about the same thing? Then, then I'm like, what are you talking about? Then you explained it to me and I was like, oh! I was like, okay, yeah, cool. You want to have a conversation? That's not a problem, sir. Bro, I was thinking about this every day, thinking, how does it fit into my life? Like, do you get what I'm saying? But yeah, it's a funny thing to me, but I think I'll always remember that. Because the conversation was so, like, it was... Out of the blue, but I will always
know when he was talking. I thought, he's gonna tell me no. That's what I actually thought. I was like, he's gonna tell me no. He doesn't want to do it, bastard.
No. But yeah, go.
No, okay. So I guess every year, most record companies do, but every year at Sony there is an internship program, right? Where they take an influx of interns. I don't know the specific number. To work across every part of the business for a year, and it's like a paid internship, and you get sort of, you know, first hand on the ground experience working inside a record company and I think they rotate them around all different departments, right? But the one place they don't do it is in A&R, and we had a conversation with the HR team, and it was like, we were like, well, we know that there's interns in here, but how comes we don't get an intern? And they were like, oh, well, would you need an intern for? I'm like, well, what about A&R? And they were like, well, we've never done it before. So can you create a role, like a job description for what that person would have to do for us to look at and consider? So we did. We just basically just think about A&R, think about what we do, and sort of end up writing a job description to create a role for, and you know, long story short, they were like, okay, look, this is fantastic. Let us actually make this official. So I guess that since 93 and in terms of Sony Music, this is the first A&R internship in the history of the company.
Wow.
Or certainly in the UK at the very least.
Because there would be a lot of people out there that like would be really good at A&R-ing, but they don't know what that actually means.
Yeah. Mm.
You know, like you explain it and it's like, okay, I could do that. I predicted this. I could do that. Do you get what? Understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's funny, right? Because I probably was 30 years old, having done quite a bit in this business before I knew what an A&R role was.
Yeah, I hear that.
Do you see what I mean? Mm. I was 26 when I first heard about publishing and probably 30 when I knew what an A&R role was. Mm. In terms of describing it, Glenn's probably going to be a better place to actually describe it.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, I think it's all, in essence, to break it down, look, in essence, and I just think about it in terms of the way that I started, it was basically, it's about being able to spot talent and its essence, but also I think it's also about being able to sort of, you know, recognize trends and recognize where culture is at and where music fits within that culture, and then being able to spot artists who artists or records or songs that are basically just encapsulate the time and appeal to an audience of people. And I think that's ultimately what you've got to recognize. That's what the job of A&R, that's the first bit of it.
And
anyway. Yeah,
and that's the bit that I think, if you do know what A&R is, that's the bit you'll identify with that. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, you find talent.
You find
right?
talent. Yeah.
Could you ask yourself, what does A&R actually mean? Artist and repertoire. What does that tell me? Yeah. Not much.
Mm. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Do you see what I mean? Like you wouldn't know what that actually means, and then you've got very functional roles within that role in terms of like what I may call the boring stuff, but the important stuff, the detail. Who wrote that song? What are the shares of the splits on that song? Who mixed it? Who mastered it? Like having that information, that data, making sure that the delivery of the song is going to happen on time by making sure I get the mastered recording at the right time to be able to upload it to, you know, DSP, Spotify, Apple Music, and the rest of it. Like, all of these things are also part of the A&R role. Yeah. But they're the invisible part, if you like.
Those are the parts that nobody talks
about. Yeah, exactly. Those are essentially the parts that, like, they will end up learning a lot about, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think the thing is, it's like I said, the talent spotting bit of it is, or the trend bit is only the first part of it.
Mm.
Then there's the other part of of record making and helping artists put their records together. But I think that's the other part of A&R. It's like literally being able to come up with the ideas for records, or at least being able to say to an artist, well, I understand the kind of records you want to make. You should go and work with that person to help you help you turn it into reality.
And sometimes it's knowing that all this artist needs is the breathing space to just do what they're doing. Yes.
Right.
Because not everyone always needs that amount of input into the process, and or some are not necessarily ready for that. You've got artists who go in and collaborate with producers and other writers and start from scratch. You've got other artists who really just want the finished beat and then they can write at home and then go and record it with an engineer. There's so many different ways that artists work, and another part of it is just recognizing how this artist works and how and what best suits.
Yeah, it's almost like, you know, someone might come to you with, you know, the ackee and salt. They might come to you with the jerk chicken, the rice and peas, and everything's crisp. It just needs to be put in a box now.
Yeah, and
a little sauce. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? So
you
might put a little sauce on it, just a tiny bit of sauce on it. Exactly. Right, now we're ready to go. We can do something with this now.
This is just about working out how best to support an artist's creative process.
Yeah.
You know, and it can take many different forms, and like sometimes you might need to just step out, get out of the way, but it's like that takes time, but that's all things to learn.
Word.
Yeah, for sure.
What's the process like? What do they have to do, like, in terms of applying? Like what is the process in that?
Click the link.
Oh yeah, I was literally, it's as simple as that. And then what, do any of them come and check you, or is it like X Factor thing where
initially you click the link, and you apply, and you apply online, and then there'll just be stages where eventually you'll meet us.
Okay, see
what I mean?
This is for anyone who feels that they have like a certain level of interest in music and and the direction of like where culture and stuff is going, yeah. But the reason why I mention that is because I think for some people the game's changing a bit now, in a sense that it used to be A&R and used to be like a heavily male dominated game. Do you know what I mean? I think now you're starting to see more women A&Rs in the game and stuff like that. But talk a little bit on that, because yeah, I'm sure that there'd be some girls that might watch it and think, they're just it automatically in their mind just think, oh, like this isn't for me.
No, that is absolutely not true.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. It has traditionally been mostly a male dominated role.
Mostly a white male dominated role.
Yeah, for real.
To be more specific, just what I mean? Because again, it's not something that is necessarily broadly advertised within our culture or within our our part of the world, if you'd like. It's like you know, where do you get the advert to become an intern, to become an A&R? Like, if unless you're already reading Music Week and all of those like professional
trade publications, and
who would be reading a trade publication in the ends? Why would you know what a trade publication is? Know what I mean? So those kind of opportunities are usually lost on people. And that was also part of the reason why we wanted to venture outside of typical outlets to speak about this, and wanted to talk to you about this as well, because we felt it important that we reached a broad spectrum of people and reach people where they are at. Basically,
yeah,
do you see
absolutely.
What I mean? So everyone has an opportunity to, apply if it's something they're interested in. Whether you're a female, whether you're black, white, or indifferent, you know, if you're into this kind of role or you're interested in it, you should apply. And there is an opportunity for you to, you know, realize your potential in this world and in this space.
It's a great. I feel like this is a great way of like fully getting into this game, because what you said as well, Glenn, is about like the internships, but there's never really been one for A&R in. Usually it's a place of like, you might intern over there and then you gradually kind of work your way or fall into it.
Yeah, that happens a
but,
lot. Yeah.
I'd never heard of anyone saying, all right, cool, this is directly for this. This is directly where it's at. And I think more and more people are having conversations or maybe having a little understanding of that role, hearing it. They might not know exactly what it entails, but they're hearing it. Do you get what I'm saying? And this way, for me, I just feel like, boy, I know straight away there's going to be a lot of people that are going to hit me and try and see if I can. I can't do that. Bro, I'm not going to be able to do that. It's got to be
DMs,
fair.
But I was
fair.
Like,
it's got to be fair.
I don't think I even quite appreciate it. So, like, sometimes you do things, right?
Yeah,
you do it for the right reasons, but you don't think of it in that kind of way.
Yeah.
And, like, the amount of people who have hit me on. Even on Instagram, or have showed up with texts, random texts on my phone or emails, and you're like, wow, this is really like hit a nerve with people. Like people are really interested and intrigued. And I almost had to remind myself that this is an example of that. It's not common.
No,
it's not a common thing that's available. So, you know, it's
also, I kind of wish it was around when I was.
Trust me, I was coming up.
You know what I mean?
I remember, like, obviously, it's well known that Benny Sky is my absolute guy, yeah? And I remember when he got the promotion for A&R, obviously, I congratulated him, but I didn't even know what that meant. I didn't even know what that was. He was just like, yeah, bro, like, oh, I'm not assistant anymore. I got, like, you know what I mean? I'm like, yeah, that's cold. Anyway, yo, so, like, what you say? What are you doing? I didn't. It was only until now, obviously, the Tinchy stuff and stuff like that happened or whatever. But that's sick. So, anyway, yeah, click the link. Yeah,
yes.
Apply for that. Yeah. And boom, I think like I wouldn't mind if you had another one of these, another opportunity or whatever, I wouldn't mind, you know, sitting down and having a conversation and talking about just what that job entails or whatever and putting it out to the people, because, you know, there's a lot of people that are looking for stuff, but they just don't necessarily know where to look. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure.
But before I end though, COVID, it's been a mad thing. But I'm curious to find out like how, and this is a big conversation and I got so much questions to ask within it. So I know we're going to have to do this properly another time, yeah? But like, how has this affected you lot from a label standpoint? Another question also is, yeah, is that, like, have you had to try to find new ways of putting out music? Like, because for at one point, everyone was kind of just in their yard.
It's funny, because at first, when COVID first happened, I think the general opinion was that streaming would go through the roof.
Yeah.
Because everyone's at home, they're just going to listen to music, blah, 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 blah. So the attitude was almost continue at how you can to put music out. Mm. Then starting to observe others putting out music and realizing that it was really tough for something to stick. So you've had albums that have come out which you've forgotten about.
Quick.
Do you know what I mean? Very quickly, because they don't live anywhere. You can't go to the club. You're not seeing it going off in the club on Instagram. Like, you're not, do you know what I mean? Like, you're not capturing the energy of it. You're not driving, you know, someone's driving past you blaring out a particular tune because everyone's in their yard. No one's really even driving. So the music was just not really living anywhere. And if anything, we had a period where we had to try and persuade artists to not put out bodies of work, put out songs and release songs, but now is probably not the best time to put out your album. It could just get lost in nothingness.
In the confusion of all of this. Do you know what I mean? Yeah.
Mm. I was looking at some artists that had tours, big tours throughout the year, you know, and those tours had to stop. And I looked at it, not even just from the misfortune of the artist, because some of the artists that I'm seeing that were doing the big tours and stuff like that, financially, they're in a good place still anyway. Mm-hmm. They can cancel it. They can go next year or whatnot. I'm looking at the engineer. Looking at the tour manager.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Maybe even the manager. You know, just the people that run the venues and all that type of stuff. I'm like, not everyone can have that.
Yeah.
That no, chill true. Out period. Do you know
very
what I mean?
True. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Everyone's lost, right? Yeah. But there's degrees of loss. You might find that you're running at 70% of what you'd normally run at, or you're running at 60% of what you normally run at. But if you're running at 0% of what you normally run at, you're in trouble. Do you see what I mean? Like, you see that there's been loads of companies who haven't survived.
Yeah,
you know, specifically in the live space, because it's gone from 100 to zero, not 100 to 65. Do you see what I mean? Like, it's literally nothing for months.
A lot of businesses now are having to kind of, in some way, downscale or whatever it may be, or even just kind of look at, okay, we have to be a little bit mindful about where we put the money and stuff like that. Mm. Is it almost, do you feel like it could be the same? Like, in terms of, do you reckon could?
I mean, I think.
I feel like the question I'm asking is, do you reckon that there could actually now be a cap of, like,
I don't think there'll be a cap. I don't know there'll be a cap. But I think it's just, you know, I think we all have to just be careful about how much we sign, or how you know, the volume of artists that we sign. Because I think, you know, capacity everywhere across many things are just reduced. So you just need to make sure that you are absolutely focused on the things that you are doing and the things that you do sign. And you can't go and just sign 20 acts. You'll never be able to focus on any of it. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I don't know that you should do that COVID or not. I don't know that you should do that. You should do that, but yeah, definitely during COVID is to kind of make that more acute. I think
overall budgets like, money's just tighter for everyone.
Yes.
Corporations, individuals, everyone. So there's going to be a little bit more scrutiny in the things that you do. However, top tier talent or top tier opportunities are still going to be top tier talent or top tier opportunities. Mm. And if you want to go into the market and try to acquire top tier talent, then you're going to have to compete on the market with everyone else.
Yeah,
the reality is that there are only, like, without getting into names, you've probably only got a couple of artists. Like, if we look just at the scene, you've probably got a couple of artists who have benefited within COVID.
Yeah.
As in, like, you can see, do you know what? That last 6 months...
You smashed it.
You, maybe you... Like, apart from the like, you know, Stormzy does it regardless of what the temperature is. Like, COVID or not, when he does something, it matters. Do you get what I'm saying? But I'm talking about for maybe artists who didn't... either didn't exist in the space before or weren't relevant in the space before, who now are leaders of the pack almost.
Trust me.
You know?
And they're like, when things eventually really get back to whatever this normal is, there's some new artists or artists that have been like putting out music or whatever that are going to be in a great space.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah, I look at like Dutch, I've been talking about Dutch for a little while. I'm like, once this thing finishes, like the tours that he's able to go and do now, you know, from some of the things that he's done, it's going to be nuts for him, and so same for a lot of a few different artists that have kind of been working and putting themselves in good positions. But listen, like I could sit and talk to, and I think that obviously I'm gonna do it again anyway, because I'm gonna, and maybe individually, because you both just have. No, actually, no, I'll do you both together because there's your journeys together. Your journeys separately are extensive, but like I feel like there's something really interesting that I could get the intricates of. And that people would really be able to benefit from. Today wasn't so much about that. Today was more about the opportunity. And whoever does get that, shout me, because I'll bust you. Shout me and say, you know what? Yeah, I got it. I want to hear that, like 100%. But I do want to end on this, man. I feel like we really appreciate you, man. And the things that you've been able to do and the way that you've like been in this business and helped push the scene to where it is, because I personally cannot normalize people like you that have come in and contributed to changing people's lives. Because the artists' lives that you change, it's not just about them, it's about their friends, it's about the people that are around them that they can also put in better situations. And we all three of us know, and Rashid's here as well, know that like we came from a time where people were just doing it. We never thought that it could ever be like that. We never thought that we could ever have that. It was more just fun, fling something out there, whatever is going to happen is going to happen. But it's just good to just have the right people that I feel personally that we could come to and say, even if we don't particularly do business together, you know the game. I can come to you and say, you know what, like, can you help me get an understanding of this, or can you help me get an understanding of that? And we wasn't able to have that at one point. So trust me, man. Appreciate you respect, guys, for doing that, man. Every time.
Love every time. Large up you and Rashid.
Yeah, man.
Respect.
Yeah, man.